Tonight we are in the Osa Peninsula, Costa Rica, and we are looking for tailless whip scorpions. This species is Paraphrynus laverfrons, and it doesn't really have a common name, but it is really quite common, so we should be seeing many out tonight. This snake certainly stands out quite a bit. On this route, we have one of Costa Rica's most enigmatic snake species, that is, this one over here, Leptodira rubricata. And over here is a crab in this hole, and we also have a shed of a snake, likely the same species. All right, great. Completely neglected to catch it on camera. Oh well, next time. This snake is commonly referred to as the black-banded cat-eyed snake. Should have been the mangrove cat-eyed snake, but that title already belongs to a boiga. This is a snake with one of the most peculiar distributions in Costa Rica. It lives only in mangroves, swamps, and around beaches, which restricts it to a band along the coast only a few kilometers wide. This band stretches from approximately the middle of the Pacific coast in Costa Rica, all the way to the Pacific coast in far western Panama. And there are a few other random records and locales. This is a mostly nocturnal and semi-arboreal species of snake. It does the majority of its hunting during high tide. What it's looking for are crabs and fish. And since not much is known about this species, there is a possibility that it eats other crustaceans as well. I mentioned that these are semi-arboreal. In a lot of the habitats that they're found in, when the tide is high, there's no ground left to rest on. So they can be considered an obligate semi-arboreal species in many cases, since they are forced up into the mangrove trees with the tides. That being said though, these are semi-aquatic. Like other Leptodira, these are venomous, but to what extent is not known. But going off of what we know about other cat-eyed snakes, their venom is likely mild. All right, we have a pretty substantial group here. There's one right here, one up here, there's one down here. There's one on this rock somewhere. Oh, it moved over to the water over here. I guess I spooked it. And there's one that's up here. I'm not going to catch them all on camera, but if you want to know how it's done, it's like this. Here are all of our tailless whip scorpions together. You can see that they don't really mind the situation too much. Incorrectly identified specimens of this species keep making their way into range maps, so it's always a little bit tricky to know exactly where these live and where they don't. But in general, it is known that they live in Nicaragua, Costa Rica, and western Panama. Throughout that area, these are habitat generalists, usually found in a wide variety of rainforests. But despite how ubiquitous they are, they do have a microhabitat preference. First, while it's not required, these are stream associated, or associated with running water in general. Second, these will live in pretty much any hole or crevice they can find, and a lot of the time that ends up being abandoned animal burrows in the ground. These are primarily nocturnal, and when you see them out, their habitat preference becomes quite clear. These mainly live on the sides of roots, trunks, fallen logs, rocks, dirt embankments, rock embankments, and otherwise vertical surfaces, with nearby crevices that they can hide in, as we just saw. And while these are considered nocturnal, if you find a dark enough spot during the day, it is possible to see these active there as well. Something that's fairly interesting about their activity is that they don't seem to be too bothered by the moon. Scorpion activity, for example, is heavily tied to the moon phase, but these tailless whip scorpions remain very reliable on nights with a bright moon. Even on a full moon, you can find quite a few of these. We've got a thicket of ferns here, and right down here on this leaf, we have a lichen-mimicking katydid. This is a katydid in the genus Pristinotus. Doesn't have a common name, but they are giant katydids. Like really, they are quite large. I showed an adult from this genus in my Costa Rican vinegaroon video, and in that clip I said that I see a lot of juveniles of this genus, but the reason I'm stopping to look at this one is because it's green. This is the first time I've ever seen this. Probably because it's not the same species. The juveniles of the gray one are still gray when they're juveniles of the same size as this one. They just look like mini versions of the adult without wings. And look, right over here, we have a dragonfly. It could end up being prey for the katydid. And looks like we have one over here as well. Yes, these katydids are primarily carnivorous, but overall omnivorous. These Pristinotus like to hang out in very humid areas of the rainforest, probably why this one is hanging out where the ferns are, but usually they aren't in areas that receive so much sunlight like this area does. During the day, they would be folded up underneath a leaf or on the side of a branch or a vine. I'm checking out another one of these rock ledges that we've been finding these tailless whip scorpions on, despite the fact that they're kind of everywhere. And I just noticed this guy up here. There's a vinegaroon, a Costa Rican vinegaroon. hidden away in the leaf litter. I would include a full clip on this species in this video, but I already made an entire video dedicated to them, so if you want to check that out, I will leave a link in the description of this video. In that same video, I called these uncommon, but since I filmed it, I've completely nailed down their microhabitat, and they have become quite easy to find, which is pretty cool. Anyway, I'll probably mention this species, Valeriophonus nara, at some point again in this video. I have a frog, Diasporus diastema, up here that I want to show you. That is this one that you see on the leaf. This is the common dink frog, or otherwise tink frog, and it is quite appropriately named. This name that they have is supposed to describe their call. The best way that I can describe this call is a drop of water falling in a metal container. Around here, this is one of the smallest frog species. Adults usually don't exceed 2 centimeters in length. This one is shorter than that, and here's my pinky nail for reference, but it is still sexually mature. This species is only found in a few of the Central American countries, that being Honduras, Nicaragua, Costa Rica, and Panama. Throughout that distribution, it's supposed to be relatively common, but I haven't had too much luck with this species, and in my personal experience, their activity has been about the same in the dry and wet season. Right now, because this one is active, you can tell that it has some orange-peach coloration, but like a lot of frogs, during the day these change to a different color, that being more pale. This one is quite likely active right now because it's in search of prey, and for this species, that's mostly ants, but also other tiny bugs. We have an Otostigmus centipede crawling around in the dirt here. This little one. This centipede is in the genus Parotostigmus, but I don't really know which species it is. However, I have narrowed it down to 3 candidates. This is either Parotostigmus goeldi, pokaki, or denticulatus. And at some point when I was wandering around at night, I did see another species from this genus, but unfortunately I didn't film it. Whichever species this is, it's typically dark brown and yellow instead of having these pink legs. I think this is some kind of local variant. I've seen it several times at this point, but not nearly as many times as I've seen the one with the yellow legs. At one point, I thought the centipedes of this size were fully grown, but then I found an individual that was about 10 centimeters long. Only one I've ever seen like that. You can hear a stream in the background right now. We found this one only a few meters away from one. These Otostigmus centipedes are associated with small streams. More specifically, they like to hang out on the dirt or rock embankments at night. These are quite sensitive to light. Usually you only have a few seconds to grab them before they find a crack in the ground that they escape into. Here on this tree trunk, we have our juvenile tailless whip scorpion. You can see it really isn't all that large. The adults of this species, and tailless whip scorpions in general, tend to be quite sedentary, mostly just sticking to one place their entire life if they can. But the juveniles like the one we have here are quite nomadic. This is an evolved method of dispersal that allows tailless whip scorpions to avoid overcrowding in certain areas. Even though you can see adult tailless whip scorpions on the ground from time to time, most often you see these juveniles crossing on the ground because they're looking for their own place to live. One of the really remarkable things about this species is their high tolerance of each other and of other species. And I don't mean other species of tailless whip scorpions. I mean that these cohabitate with a long list of other animals, including crabs, lizards, frogs, tarantulas, leafcutter ants, and a whole lot else. If that makes it sound like these do not have any predators, I am here to tell you that that is false. There isn't a whole lot of data on what eats these, but we do have some examples of predators, including wandering spiders. I told myself earlier tonight that I wasn't going to search along streams to find these tailless whip scorpions, because there's always so many plants and other crap in the way. But I realized that I want to show you guys a tailless whip scorpion that has an egg sac on the bottom of it, which means that I might have to find quite a few before I come across just one that has one of these egg sacs, because they can be quite rare, actually. Anyway, at this point, I think I've seen over 50 of these tailless whip scorpions. In fact, I just saw one move down here. Yeah, there's one right down here. Here in this vine, we have a brush-nosed weevil, and I have shown these on the channel before, but both of the ones that I showed were females, and females do not have the brush nose like this one does. This brush or beard that they have isn't the only unique morphology on this beetle. One thing that's kind of interesting about them is that they have this heavily pitted thorax, or full of a bunch of small dents, and their front legs are longer than their back legs, which is quite a rare trait for weevils. Rhinostomus barbarostris has quite a range. It's found in practically all of the mainland tropics in the Americas. The distribution of the entire genus spans into other continents as well. There's a species in southeastern Africa, as well as one in Southeast Asia. But even being the most common species in its genus, I still find the bearded weevil to be the coolest one. It's the largest species in its genus, and one of the largest weevils in the world. Much to the dismay of farmers, this is a beetle whose larvae develop in palm trees. But this one is not to be confused with the South American palm weevil. That is a different species altogether, called Rhynchophorus palmarum, and it happens to have roughly the same range as this one. And look what I just noticed out of the corner of my eye. Down here is a mating pair of tree frogs. These tree frogs are Smiliscus sordida, and at this point I've seen Amplexus several times. This is quite a common species around here. And look, there's a little one right here. I'm sorry that you have to witness this, little buddy. We have a Dipsis tenuissima on this little shrub here. That is a snail-eating snake. It's a little far out, but I'm sure I can catch it. This species is commonly referred to as Taylor's snail-eating snake, and this is my first time seeing one. This is a regional endemic. It is only found on the Osa Peninsula in Costa Rica, as well as parts of the neighboring coast, including in western Panama. This snake reminds me quite a bit of Cybin nebulatus, the cloudy snail-eating snake, and that is a species that has been shown on this channel before. It is quite closely related to snakes in the genus Dipsis, like the one that we're looking at here, and part of the reason that the genus Dipsis is polyphyletic, since Cybin nebulatus is nested within them. This snake shares practically all of the same habits. It's associated with rainy nights, or nights following rains. It tends to live near streams, and of course it has the same diet, that being slugs and snails, which is the reason that they like rain. Lastly, the second name in the binomial Dipsis tenuissima is an adaptation of the Latin word tenuissimus, which translates to slimmest, in reference to this snake's body proportions. This here is the ideal place to search for Paraphrynus laevifrons. I don't really need to tell you this since they're already quite easy to find, but if you want to see dozens in a night, these are the places to search. And that is for a few reasons. One, we have a stream here, and they are stream associated. Second, the surface is very vertical, which is something they like a lot. It's full of little crevices, and this is where they hang out during the day. And I have seen quite a few juveniles on this surface here. And there was also an adult through here. You can barely see it in the video, but it's there. There's other adults too, but I think I've scared them away. Trying to get this stick insect from down here. I believe that this stick insect is Aliena bostra, but I can't be 100% sure when they are not adults. Even then, I'm kind of shaky on my ID. And despite the fact that these are green, I have been seeing quite a few of them. For me, this is the second most common genus after Metrophasma. The adults of this genus are not so common, however. I've only seen two at this point. The really little ones, as in much smaller than the one that we have here, are fairly reliable. I'm not too sure why, but they frequently hang out on the undersides of heliconia leaves at night. But this might just be a bias, since it is easier to spot them on a plain surface. That being said though, I still don't understand why these are more common at night. I have never seen them in motion. These definitely have a strong preference for a certain microhabitat. This microhabitat isn't all that specific, it's just dense vegetation that receives a lot of light. But I think it is worth saying because I have not seen a single one of these in open forest. Right here, we have a not so large tailless whip scorpion. And then over here, we have a pretty small one too. Smallest one I've seen tonight. And right here, we have a very large one. You can see that it's not very happy with me. And this one is actually a mother. And I'll find some way of filming it without disturbing her. But she does have an egg case on the bottom of her abdomen. These Paraphrynus laevifrons do not have a mating season. All aspects of their reproductive cycle occur year-round. This is true for a lot of amblypygid species that live in the tropics. While the female that we have here is quite large, these become sexually mature at around half the size of this one, though it is less common to see tailless whip scorpions of that size with egg sacs. For this species, it'll likely take a little over 3 months for them to hatch. The brown surface that you see is the covering for the eggs that makes up the sac. If it didn't have this thin cover, you would see that the eggs are nearly white. The first instars of this species are a kind of peach color with a slightly green abdomen. These first instars are called prey nymphs. Then after their first molt, they start to look like the last one that we saw, or the two that were sitting next to this female. They get that red coloration on the pedipalps, which are the raptorial arms, and a white crown around the prosoma. What's kind of interesting about this is that the Europygii, or the vinegaroons, often have red pedipalps as juveniles as well. I know the species that's around here certainly does. Just like these vinegaroons, obviously, since we've seen adults, that red coloration fades over time, though they do retain a little bit of it at the extremities of their legs, pedipalps, and chelicerae. Well then, I think we've bothered her enough, but I'd say we got pretty good footage of her egg sac without having to handle her. So that's pretty cool. Well, that is all of the tailless whip scorpions that we are going to see tonight. So, as always, hope you enjoyed, and thank you for watching.